Oh, hey folks, Chris Garlock back with Michael Redmond, AlphaGo versus the world. And we have a repeat player. This is somebody we just did one of his games, and I really enjoyed that last game. Mr. Gouli got pretty far, so we can skip the intro, I think, right? Because we've already done
that. Yeah, Gouli got a second chance. And he's playing with white this time.
Ah.
So AlphaGo plays a star point and a 3-4 point. And in the patterns that we were seeing in most of the games, white played a star point in the upper left corner and a 3-4 point in the lower left corner.
Mm-hmm.
And so the white stones are different in the way they correspond to the black stones. And this, it turns out, this changed the way AlphaGo played. So it is a different formation. The fact that the white stone that is on the 3-4 point is adjacent to the black stone that is on the 4-4 point. It makes it different. So AlphaGo did not play the large knight's corner enclosure that it liked so much, but it played the two-space large shimari. And this is the one that we're going to see it continue playing a lot in the later evolution of the master version and also in the AlphaGo Zero version. White plays here. This makes sense. White is playing a low position there. To reduce the value of black's high position in the lower right corner. So I like this move. And black plays a shoulder hit. This is a pattern that we see a lot in later versions also. Mm-hmm. So this is pretty pretty normal, you might say. And white answers it. And more I'm seeing in various board positions, I'm seeing computer programs not wanting to answer the shoulder hit. So white's just going to play away. I've marked 3 points in the upper left corner. Those are 3 points where white could have played a corner enclosure. And so while human players always used to think that white should either push here or curl here in answer to a shoulder hit, more and more we're seeing in various game positions, we're seeing white play away instead of answering it. And in fact, in the master versus zero set of games, I think a number of times we saw white playing something like this. And it was very hard for me to understand at the time.
But I'm sure by the time we get to those games, you will totally have it sussed out.
Well, I'll pretend at least.
There we go. That'll work.
White plays a pincer. And the pincer is bad. So white was supposed to play here. Something like this.
Sneak preview. At some point, do these guys figure it out and stop pincering, or are we just going to see pincering for 60 games?
I think we needed to see the scores given to us by computer programs before we actually believed it. And it was just too hard to believe. We always thought that pressing here was maybe giving white too much territory. We thought it was a bit weak in territory. Recently, people have been playing the knight's move at the second line, but at the time, people just jumped. Actually, this move was played by Chongqing. We should give kudos to Chongqing because he played it. But people didn't really think well of that move, and we thought that we should jump on the third line. The difference between this move and this move is that this move is not giving forcing moves to black. Whereas this move, black does have, can start pushing on the fourth line here pretty forcefully. So there's a difference there. It makes a difference in the fighting on the left half of the board. So black plays here. And this is AlphaGo playing his shoulder hit thing, or, well, its shoulder hit thing. And nowadays, this is, I think in later versions, this kind of move disappeared. And in modern computer programs like Lila Zero and Katago, I'm seeing this one more. This is what I ended up with in my analysis. Like, people who use programs might not always be getting the same answers as I do, because I sort of sift through various variations that are suggested moves, and I choose the one that works best for my commentary, basically, or that I would want to play.
Right.
So sometimes it's not always the best number for both programs. But this is what I come up with here. This looks like something I would be happy to play.
But I think that's an important point that anybody should do that. I mean, even amateurs should do that. They should play with Nakayama said that. Play what you want to play.
You want to play because you're going to be able to follow it up. If you're getting into a position that you feel happy with, is very important. Because it generally means that you're going to be able to continue playing well.
Right.
And in this position, it's pretty easy for me to see that this exchange has potential, is giving extra potential to black towards the lower side. And it looks like it's a good exchange for black. It's just that white stones are strong anyway. These stones are strong anyway. And so the black stone has more potential to be an effective stone. So I sort of like this position for black, and it's something that I understand why I think black is good. So black jumps here, and it's sort of, it's not so clear how I'm going to use this stone, so I wouldn't like this so much. And actually, it turns out white should have pushed here. I agree with this, too. It makes sense. White pushes here for a while and then plays a tight move on the left side. The combination of pushing from the right and then defending on the left, it's very efficient. The fact that white has reinforced black here, the negative aspect of that is that white gets weaker on the left side. So by combining that with playing a solid move on the left side, it works very well. And of course, white's gain here is that white is getting some stones that are pointing to the right half of the board, which is what white wanted to do.
Do you have a sense that Gulli has adapted his game at all for Master, or is he still playing his own game pretty much?
I think to a certain extent, he's still playing his own game. He was already world champion several times, like I think it was 8 times that he was world champion, and very much established in his style. So for a player like that, it's relatively difficult to change. Like if you're a young player and you're still changing anyway, and maybe your style was not so successful as Gulli's was, like he was so successful. When you're so successful like that, it's difficult to start from zero again and start something. Because when he started out doing that, he would probably start by having negative results, worse results than he did before when he was playing his own style. So there's a price that has to be paid, especially when you start out being a very successful player. So I think he's one of the players who did not change so much as the younger players did.
Right. That makes sense.
And so, okay, I've jumped a bit ahead in the game. Black jumps in here. So white's move was the Wariuchi, this move here. You might remember something I've said about moves like this.
You don't like it, and the computer doesn't like it.
The computer doesn't like it. And so this is going to take, white has to pay for that. And so the other option was to be pushing here. I like this variation very much more, this one where white gets to add a stone to the left side. It turns out white's going to get into a bit of trouble on the left side of the board when black jumps in here. Now white jumps out, black attaches in the corner. And this is where the players I discussed this game with directly after the game, this is where people were saying white went wrong. And so it is a point where white's winning percentage goes down. After white plays here and black connects underneath with this, we get into this kind of position. At this point, black is already over 60%. Black has something like 62%, which translates to 11 points before combing. That's a pretty solid lead. And this is something that people were seeing and saying that this is just a bit painful for white. And the answer to that is, why did not white play here a more strong local move? And this gets pretty insanely complicated. I chose one variation that's relatively, extending here is going to be relatively easy for white to execute. The other variation would be to extend down here, which is actually much more complicated. So I'll just ignore that one for this video and go into this one. This is relatively easy because white can immediately capture the two black stones.
Mm-hmm.
Black will play like this, and something like this will follow. Black did get a lot of nice forcing moves here, but white got the territory. So white has taken territory in the corner, Black did get a very nice shape on the outside here that I've sort of outlined. But White's group on the left, which is this group here, which is the one that could get into trouble, it does have that peep at A, which is not being affected by all this stuff that happened in the corner. White still has that shape there, where, for instance, if Black plays on the top, White can play here and get a fairly good shape without doing any damage to the corner. So actually being squeezed like that did not take this option away from White. It means that White will have a relatively safe position there. White might actually start with this side. This also is threatening to play here next, putting a little bit of pressure on the Black group, also making a base on the side. So actually this White group on the left side is not in so much trouble yet if White plays this way. And the fact that White has taken the corner, although Black got to squeeze it, the fact that this is such a solid territory here means that Black has run out of forcing moves. So this would be actually a playable variation for White. White could have played this way and stayed in the game. But when White played here, trying to avoid getting into too much trouble on the left side, actually this made it worse for White. Because just because Black has White's territory is smaller in the corner, and Black having this forcing move here, Black can capture the one stone here at any point. It just makes Black so much stronger. It takes away some of the strength of White's group on the left side too. So at this point, let's see, it is 62% at this point. Uh-huh. And it's getting better for Black. Like when White plays a key point here, typically when AlphaGo is playing Black, it's very rare to see Black play this move, which would connect the Black group. Quite often, AlphaGo just allows White to cut Black off there. And actually, this is the second game in the series where something like this happened. So at this point, the winning percentage for Black is already something like 66.5%. So that's 13 points before Komi. This is where I'm sort of ending my commentary for this video. But I will show you some moves just to show you how this local fight turned out. It got a bit exciting. But Black gets to cut here. And you can see sort of the idea with Black pressing here and getting a lot of forcing moves following up that is sort of demonstrated in this game variation. And Black ends up connecting up like this. And lo and behold, White is ending up with a eyeless group here. This White, you know, and all of Black's groups are pretty strong. It's the same pattern that we've been seeing before. And it's very, I think it's important to notice that the White groups that have been reinforced here are the groups that were strong to start out with. Black is reinforcing those. It's very basic theory to do that for Black. It's just following some basic theories that we already knew, but doing it so much better than the human player. So this White group is going to be pushed around throughout the game, and AlphaGo is not going to bother to kill it, but it's just going to have this great advantage in the rest of the board. The fact that the Black groups are strong makes it that much easier for Black. So I think I should end here.
Yeah, I'm just having a hard time wrapping my mind around that this is, you know, 8-time world champion Gu Li. You know, I mean, I was so impressed with his last game where he was just calm and, you know, hanging in there. And here, you know, it's just Swiss cheese.
I just say that it demonstrates the power of this pressing move here. Yes. And the follow-ups that Black has with that Joseki, the way that AlphaGo is using them, is just very powerful.
It's beautiful. I don't know about you all watching, but I am really enjoying these. So I guess I can see that Steven is enjoying them as well. So that's a couple of us. But no, seriously, folks, I hope you're enjoying this series. More to come of some 28 or so, if I'm not mistaken, somewhere in that neighborhood. We will be doing all 60 of these master games, and each one of them is a little mini adventure. So stay tuned, and thanks for watching, and we will see you next time.